Mariner Books and Harper Audio present The Voice That Challenged a Nation, Marian Anderson and the Struggle for Equal Rights, by Russell Freedman. Read by Je Nie Fleming.
To Emmanuel d'Amenville, a friendship as had mastered time. 1. Easter Sunday, April 9th, 1939. Lord, I got a right. Lord, I got a right. Lord, I got a right. I got a right to the tree of life. African American spiritual. Despite cold and threatening weather, the crowd began to assemble long before the concert was to begin. People arrived singly and in pairs and in large animated groups. Soon, the streets leading to the mall in Washington, D.C., were jammed with thousands of people heading for the Lincoln Memorial. The earliest arrivals found places as close as possible to the steps of the great marble monument. As the crowd grew, it spread back along the mall, stretching around both sides of the long reflecting pool and extending beyond to the base of the Washington Monument, 3/4 of a mile away. Baby carriages were parked among the trees. Folks cradled sleeping infants in their arms and held youngsters by the hand, or propped up on their shoulders. Uniformed Boy Scouts moved through the festive holiday throng, handing out programs. Anticipating a huge turnout, the National Park Service had enlisted the help of some 500 Washington police officers. By 5 o'clock that afternoon, when the concert was scheduled to start, an estimated 75,000 people had gathered on the mall. They waited patiently under overcast skies, bundled up against the brisk wind that whipped in from the Potomac River. They had come on this chilly Easter Sunday to hear one of the great voices of the time and to demonstrate their support for racial justice in the nation's capital. Marian Anderson had been applauded by many of the crowned heads of Europe. She had been welcomed at the White House, where she sang for the President and First Lady, Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt. She had performed before appreciative audiences in concert halls across the United States. But because she was an African American, she had been denied the right to sing at Constitution Hall, Washington's largest and finest auditorium. The Daughters of the American Revolution, the patriotic organization that owned Constitution Hall, had ruled several years earlier that black artists would not be permitted to appear there. News of the DAR's ban had caused an angry controversy and set the stage for a historic event in the struggle for civil rights. Working behind the scenes, a group of influential political figures had found an appropriate concert space for Anderson. Barred from Constitution Hall, she would give a free open-air concert on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. Shortly before the concert got underway, the skies above Washington began to clear. Clouds, which had shadowed the monument, skittered away to the north, and the late afternoon sun broke through to bathe the reflecting pool and shine on the gaily dressed Easter crowd. Secretary of the Interior, Harold L. Ickes, appeared on the speaker's platform. He introduced Miss Anderson, and she stepped forward to the bank of microphones. The massive figure of Abraham Lincoln gazed down at her as she looked out at the expectant throng. Silencing the ovation with a slight wave of her hand, she paused. A profound hush settled over the crowd. For that moment, Marian Anderson seemed vulnerable and alone. Then she closed her eyes, lifted her head, clasped her hands before her, and began to sing. 2. 25 cents a song. I sang naturally, as free as a bird. Marian Anderson loved to sing, and she loved to listen while others were singing. At Philadelphia's Stanton Elementary School, her fourth grade classroom was next to the room where the children went to learn songs. On those days, she remembered, "I did not hear a word my teacher spoke. I was as completely in that other room as one could be while one's body was elsewhere. When the day came for our class to go there for singing, I was the happiest child in the school." She sang for the sheer joy of singing, and her uniquely beautiful voice delighted everyone who knew her. At the Union Baptist Church, where her family worshiped, she had been an enthusiastic member of the junior choir ever since her sixth birthday. Alexander Robinson, the man who led the choir, recognized the youngster's musical gifts and her eagerness to learn and to perform. And he discovered that she had an unusually wide vocal range. She could sing any part with ease. While her voice had the rich, dark timbre of contralto, the lowest female voice, she had no trouble with the ringing tones of soprano, the highest. Soon, she was singing well enough to be entrusted with solos when the junior choir performed at the church's main Sunday service. Marian's Aunt Mary sang in the senior choir. She began to take her niece to local benefits and community events where Marian would be asked to sing a song or two and would earn 25 or even 50 cents. As word of her talent spread, Aunt Mary had handbills printed with a picture of Marian and the words, "Come and hear the baby contralto, 10 years old." About this time, Marian was invited to join the People's Chorus, made up of 100 voices recruited from Black church choirs all over the city. She became one of the youngest and smallest members of the chorus. The director, Emma Azalea Hackley, wanted to make sure that Marian would not be lost in the crowd. So, she had her stand on a chair whenever she sang a solo. "I want her to feel elevated," said Hackley. "And I want no one in the back of the hall to have the slightest difficulty in seeing her." Marian lived with her parents, John and Anna Anderson, and two younger sisters, Elise and Ethel May, in South Philadelphia, where she was born on February 27, 1897, 3 decades after the end of slavery in America. She grew up in a poor but vibrant neighborhood, home to Irish, Italian, and Jewish immigrants, and to African-American families that had come up from the rural South to seek job opportunities in the city. "I don't remember being conscious of any difference between me and white children when I was a small child," Anderson told an interviewer years later. "I think this was because there were white and Negro families mingled on our block, and all the children played together. We were in and out of each other's houses all day long." Blacks, the polite term at that time was Negro, and whites lived side by side in South Philadelphia. But as Marian grew older, she learned that prejudice and discrimination often kept the races apart. Blacks worshipped in segregated churches, which provided sanctuary against the pain of discrimination. At Union Baptist Church, Marian heard a gospel of dignity and pride. "There were times when we heard our relatives and friends talking," she remembered, "and we knew we might come in contact with racial discrimination. In some stores, we might have to stand around longer than other people until we were waited on. There were times when we stood on a street corner waiting for a trolley car, and the motorman would pass us by. There were places in town where all people could go, and there were others where some of us could not go. There were girls we played with, and others we didn't. There were parties we went to, and some we didn't. We were interested in neither the places nor the people who did not want us." Marian's grammar school, like her neighborhood, was racially mixed, with Black students and white students, but all the teachers were white. In Philadelphia at the time, Black teachers were allowed to teach only in schools.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.